Welcome on. Ashutosh Sinha, sir, Argos, India. Sir, we humbly state that during the ongoing pandemic, BIMM quickly adapted and embraced the concept of online teaching and learning from the month of April 2020. Madam, we also proudly state that for the batch 2019 to 21, which passed out, and the current batch of 2020 to 22, we successfully conducted the semester exams online in the month of April 2021, which were proctored. This has enabled us to stick to the calendar without any loss to the students. Sir, all the senior student managers at Balaji Institute of Modern Management, BIMM, took up projects in the work from home mode, while some of us took up projects on the field. All this aimed towards enhancing our learning and also to learn the practical aspects of our curriculum. May I now request Dr. Archana Srivastava, Madam, Director of BIMM, to welcome the guest.
Thank you, Malvika. I'm delighted to welcome Mr. Ashutosh Sinha. Sir, on behalf of Sri Balaji University, I extend a very warm welcome to you. Sir, of course, is a very astute professional, and today is going to talk about a wonderful business model. So a lot of learning is waiting for us. Sir, I welcome you very warmly to the university.
Thank you, ma'am. And thank you for having me. And I must say that the topic you have chosen is fantastic. So innovation and ingenuity.
Ashutosh, sir, if you don't mind, can I interrupt you for a minute, sir?
Sure, sir.
Sir, our computer will carry out the formality of introducing you, sir.
So okay.
Our audience fantastic. Is familiar with you in a better and bigger way, sir.
Okay.
Malvika, please. Right,
may I now request Student Manager Parth Agarwal to introduce our guest, Ashutosh Sinha, sir, Argos, India. Over to you, Parth.
Thank you, Malvika. As correctly said by Paul McCartney, there must be a better way to make the things we want. A way that doesn't spoil the sky or the rain or the land. I, Parth Agarwal, Student Manager, Balaji Institute of Modern Management, Sri Balaji University, Pune, I am honored and extend a warm welcome to Mr. Ashutosh Kumar Sinha, Business Head at Argos. Sir has expanded his academic proficiency from National Institute of Agriculture, Hyderabad, Rajendra Agriculture University, Bihar. Sir carries a rich experience of working with big giants such as Argos, LT Foods, Wilgrove, Innovation Private Limited, British Petroleum Energy Private Limited, Godrej Agrovet Limited, and Adventa India Limited. Sir is a business head with over 2 decades of leadership experience in agricultural input, animal farming, sustainable renewable energy, rural distribution management, and helping startup scale. Deep experience in marketing, sales, product management, supply chain, business strategy, business modeling, startup, business incubation, consulting, and investment raise. Sir has proficiency in numerous fields such as farmer engagement, contract farming, sustainability, agriculture, fundraising, business development, business plan, concept development, consulting, development, entrepreneur market planning, market research, marketing, procurement, retail, sales, and scientific and supply chain. Sir has been conferred multiple awards during his career, namely Prerna Fellow 2013 of IIM Lucknow and alumnus of Dasra Social Impact, awarded as 50th most influential rural marketing professional in 2017 and 16, 25th most talented rural marketing professional in 2014 by World Bank Congress, speaking at leading business management institutes like IIM Ahmedabad, Manage Hyderabad, Agriculture and Food Institute Mysore, VIT Vellore. We are very enthusiastic to listen more from you, sir. The virtual platform is all yours. Over to you, sir.
Thank you for this fantastic listening to your accolades, right? But it also tells you that, okay, the journey has been long and it's further going ahead. And I welcome you all, in fact, to this long journey of creating a niche for you, creating a space for you, and creating impact for others. So thank you, everyone. So Vikas sir, can I go ahead now?
Yes, sir. Please go ahead, sir. I'm sorry for the interruption, sir.
No, thank you. It's sometimes you get so enthusiastic that you jump the queue and So now I'm really excited, and thanks for having me. And I was telling that the topic is very close to my heart, innovation and ingenuity and marketing. It's so close that the company I founded, Willgrow Marketing, has a name in innovation in that. So it was called Willgrow Innovation Marketing Private Limited. And sometimes jokingly, we used to say that this word innovation is so innovative that anyone can define it in whichever way they want it. Okay. Okay. So what I would do is that Paul has said me that you all eager to listen, but I'll say that let's discuss, right? Because any place wherever you think that you need to know more, or you need to correct me, or you need to interrupt me, or you need to ask something or add something, you're welcome. So let's be on the same platform of speaking from the both sides. Okay. So I'll be very happy if you ask a question or if you add something, because many things I don't know which you guys know, right? So please, please feel free to interrupt me and keep asking questions. Okay. So I plan to do through this. There's 3-4 slides which I will be showing, but mostly it will be a discussion so that we understand the why of things, why we are doing this and what we are doing, right? Just instead of just telling that this is what we are doing. And so while the presentation is mostly on my current work, Argos, but maybe we can discuss whichever way you want, because there's some experience I carry in working other sector also, and would be happy to correlate things if it interests you. Okay. And if any point in time you feel boring, you just stop me. Okay. So let me share my screen. Just give me 1 second.
Sir, may I suggest, sir, at the bottom of the screen, sir, share screen that.
Yeah that's
up arrow, sir. Yeah, and if your presentation is open before we click on that.
It's open, but it's, I don't know what's happening. It's asking security and privacy. It never asked before. So, okay. There's some firewall which is stopping me.
Yeah, you can enable it, ma'am. Whatever the settings, Ashutosh sir, you have no. Just allow them. Yeah, otherwise, if you can do one thing, you can email the PPT. Maybe
I'll just do that. I think that
will run it for you.
Okay, allow me 1 or 2 minutes. I'm sending it to, there's something which is, My computer is not allowing somehow to share my screen. And
sir, if you can mail the PPT to me, sir, I'll share it from my end.
Okay. I'm doing it. Just give me 1 minute, I'll rejoin.
Sure.
Okay, I think it's visible now.
Yes, sir. The PPT is visible, sir.
Okay, so let's go ahead. I don't know, it is not getting into presentation mode. Some problem somewhere.
Sir, have you logged in from two devices, sir? We can see.
Yeah, I've logged in.
We can see two images, sir.
Okay, so let me do it to computer. Somehow I'm not able to forward it also. So this is I'm trying to be innovative, trying to log in from two devices so that we can fit. I think it's okay.
Yes, so we can hear you now.
Yeah, it's
and
okay.
See your
it's
PPT
okay.
Also.
Okay, great then. Okay, so this is what we do. I will have. I think there was an echo. So now it's okay, right? Okay. So let's go ahead. So this is what we do, guys. We say, let's deposit some grain in the bank. This is what does it. Please keep me telling that I'm audible. Otherwise, I'm lost completely.
You're audible, sir.
Okay. So this is what we do. That we tell people, our farmers, that let's deposit some grain in the bank. And this looks very something which is uncommon or unheard of kind of thing, that how do you deposit some grain in the bank? It's not possible, right? But our business model is that we are saying that, okay, let's deposit some grain in the bank. And presentation has gone. So what we do, friends, is that we have a grain bank. So farmers, when you talk to farmers, what they do, farmers produce grains. And then this grain is sold. We are creating banks for that grain. And why we call it bank and why not we call it warehousing? Because what do you do in warehousing? If you go to the warehouse, it's a space rental business. You take some space for them. You say that, okay, I want 100 square meter space or 100 square feet space that takes X amount of grains. I'll deposit my 50 tons of grains there. Whenever I require it, I'll take it back or I will sell it. So that's warehousing. But that warehousing doesn't solve the problem the farmers have, because small farmers don't have either the minimum lot size for warehousing, which is say 3 tons to 100 tons, depending on different warehousing. So they can't go and deposit them. So they said, okay, let's not do warehousing. Let's do banking. What do you do in bank? So bank, you go and deposit, suppose 1,000 rupees with 5 200 rupees notes. And when you want to take it back, you will get back your 1,000 rupees, but not the same bank, the same note. You will get 2 500 rupees or any other combination of the currency. What remains intact in value, but the instrument changes. And that's the banking is, and that's the innovation in our model, that what we tried to do is that, okay, you bring in your grain and it becomes fungible, it becomes interchangeable, like in bank, currencies gets interchangeable, right? So suddenly, when you think like that, what happens is even a small farmer who wants to bring in, say, 2 bags of it, so he can deposit the grain with us. We make them immediately we digitize that grain. So what it means is that the 2 bags of grain or whatever number of bags, after looking at the quality, after saying that, okay, today's price, suppose someone brings maize, 2 quintal maize, and say that, okay, today's price is 1500 rupees. So there's a passbook in their mobile app, which is Grain Bank mobile app, where we'll say that, okay, you have 2 quintal of maize, 1500 rupees each quintal. So 3000 rupees is the value of that grain. And that is digitized immediately after it comes to us, after quality checking and onboarding, that gets into his mobile app. Now that 2 quintal of grain is mixed to other people's grain, like in bank, where our money is mixed with everyone's money, and then it is loses its linked identity to the person. So it's not linked to Ashutosh Sinha that he has deposited this 500 rupees note. It can be anyone's. So that allows us to aggregate without linking it to individual farmers. So this 2 bags has been digitized, and now 100-ton stock, a stack, or 1,000-ton stack or warehouse becomes the whole as a uniform depository of grain, where this guy's 2 quintal is hidden somewhere. Now this person, because it is digitized and it has a value in his mobile app, what he can do is that, and every day we keep on supplying the prices, we keep on telling that what is the price of the market today. So when he deposited, it was 1500 rupees, and today if it is 1550 rupees, or even sometimes it can be less also, depending on my market fluctuation. So he knows exactly how much value of the grain he has in his wallet, in the mobile app. And he wants to sell it out of 2 quintal. If he has 2 quintal as 4 bags, so he wants to sell 1 bag. He can sell 1 bag. He can hold it, or he can buy some. If you want to buy some more, he can buy it also. So it becomes completely tradable, digitized asset. Like if I can draw some similarity, it's like sharing share trading. If you are doing a share trading, you can freely sell and buy your digital assets. So the grain which is a physical asset, so we say it's a physical digital interface. So physically we manage warehouses where grains are kept as per scientific norms, so that the grains are saved, and digitally it's converted into assets so that it can be, the farmers can participate in market directly. So that's the precisely in a small description is our business model. So it's a physical digital business model. The innovation being the biggest innovation being is that it's fungible. So that what it does in a way, if you look at why we need to do it. So one thing what we discussed is that because the farmers, the small farmers, they don't have minimum lot size to go to the warehousing. So if you go to a warehousing, they'll say, okay, bring in at least 3 tons or 5 tons. And farmers don't have that. So they, even if they want, they can't go into the warehouse. Second, the warehouses are not available. So the second innovation, which is not just innovation, but it's a operational challenge, operation puzzle, which is getting solved, is how do you operate smaller warehouses? So normal grain commodity warehouses, if you go and see warehouses, it will be anything between 1,000 ton capacity to 100,000 tons capacity. So that's where it operates. And when you have bigger warehouses, you come closer to market, you come closer to railhead or roadhead from where you can market it. And these are places where 30 to 50 kilometers from the villages. If you want to go to the villages, you need smaller warehouses. Otherwise, you'll not have enough material to really fill it up. So our warehouses, we say that anything 500 tons and more will take. So on an average, we have all our warehouses are between 500 tons to 2,000 tons. There are some warehouses slightly bigger. There are some just slightly smaller. But on an average, we have around 700-800 tons capacity of warehouse. So no warehouse company anywhere in the world has said that we'll be able to operate 500-700 tons capacity warehouse profitably. So there are warehouses available, which are constructed by different people and government agencies like PACS, Primary Agriculture Cooperative Societies. The NAWARD has funded a lot of them. But most of them are lying vacant because it's kind of, I won't say impossible because we have made it possible, but it's very difficult to operate those warehouses profitably and fulfill all the statutory requirement. So there's an agency called WDRA, which is Warehouse Development Regulatory Authority, which mandates that what are the things which should be there in the warehouse. It should have security guards, it should have multiple other infrastructure things like fenced wires, etc., which are very difficult to do in smaller warehouses. So that is another sort of innovation where we have got into that. How do we? So this is how the mobile app looks. This is an older version. We have a newer UI, which is much more trendy. The thing is that how do you operate that smaller warehouses? So what we have done is that we have created an organizational structure where there's a person called village champion. So we call our model as a relationship model. So this infrastructure is created close to the farmhouse or farm. So we call it farm gate warehouse, 500, 700, 1,000 tons, where farmer can reach by themselves. They bring in their material either on their tractor or bullock cart or even motorcycle or cycles. So they can come in. So this is smaller, but the person who's managing it with other support also is called village champion. We call it champion because this is where he goes and meets farmers. He does all the relationship and sales pitch with the farmer, and he brings him there. But being a village champion, which is local, and also a warehouse, which is within village, it provides a social security kind of thing, a security or safety kind of thing. We have never found any safety concern despite not having a security guard. So if you ask anyone in warehousing industry that can you operate a warehouse without a security guard, they'll say it's impossible. You will not get the licenses also. But we have been able to work with government also to allow that, okay, you can get WDRA registration without even having security guards. So these are small innovation, but it looks very interesting to see on the ground that how do you ensure safety, because there's crores of worth of material in a warehouse and you need insurance cover. So there has to be lot of legwork that has to be done with government and insurance company, but we are proud that Argos has been able to do that, and that's why we are able to bring that warehouse closer to the farm. So this is on the infrastructure front. So I'm saying there's innovation in terms of infrastructure thing, that it came closer to the farmer, smaller warehouses and so forth. a security by society and village champion, and other things like. The third part is that is this warehouses, because this is distributed smaller, there's a control issue. So there's a lot of organizational system there, but we call ourselves as agri-tech company and investing a lot of money in terms of not just on this platform for digitizing and trading, but also on warehousing management. So some of the warehouses which we have created as model warehouses, which still developing, has almost automated commodity health report. You can watch it from anywhere. So it's our computer region. We are using artificial intelligence. We're using RFID and IoT to keep track of each bag. So some of the newer things what we are trying to do is that insert a small IoT device in each bag or in a stack of bag, which gives you how the grain is behaving in terms of its health. How is its moisture content? What is the temperature? What is the carbon dioxide content? What is the fungal content? So that we know that this is what the quality of the grain. So that's the technology intervention that's happening. And this is required because what do you do with this grain? This grain has to be sold to the market. And when we tell a farmer that come to us, participate directly in the market, you might get better return because the market when it is high can give you much higher return and you should be playing into that. So to do that, we need to connect it to larger buyers and they need all this certificate. And what is your commodity health report? How it is behaving? Can we get viable size, like 50 tons, 25 tons, 100 ton truck, can it reach there? And do we have this transparent quality reports? It says this technology works there. So this creates intermediation disintermediation from both sides, from the farmer to bringing to warehouse and from the buyer who has to depend on multiple parties to reach to them. So that's where this platform works. Now, so if you look at this impact, what people have been done, people have got in last 3-4 years, 4 years we say, there on average 25-30% extra income it has generated on multiple count. The one count being of course the better prices because farmers are able to sell it when the market is up, market is good. Second is they have been able to stop losses, which otherwise they would have, if they would have stored it in their houses. Many studies show that it can be anywhere between 10% to 30%. So that's another big loss. So if we add that, the impact will be much more. And the pricing, payment fraud, all kind of things, if you add in this, the impact is much bigger. So that's what we are trying to do. So creating infrastructure and system which where farmers and buyers can participate directly, transparently, have a warehousing solution which is done as per the best scientific methods, have complete transparency. So this is what is working. To my mind, the biggest change that companies like Argos and when you work in different sector can bring in to change some of the behavioral patterns in the farmers, how they do participate post-harvest. This is all post-harvest, right? We have businesses in pre-harvest also, but I'm just focusing on post-harvest right now. So farmers, being farmer, they are producers. So once they produce their grains, they say that, okay, we have done enough risk-taking. We have produced our grains despite good rain, bad rain, heat, diseases, pest, et cetera. Let's not take any further risk and sell it off. So they do it because, one, they need money immediately. They have taken a lot of loans. So we do provide loan we have tie up with banks which provide loan at bank rate. So if you look at normal interest rate from informal sector in the villages, it will be between 1% and 3% per month. So 1% people rarely get, so minimum they can get it 2%. So 24 to 36% interest rate. What we provide is at 12%. That's the bank rate. So people need not sell in desperation. If they need money, they can get it. The second thing is that they say that we don't know how to trade. Okay, so that's where that's the whole education program that goes on, and all our relationship is based on that. So it's like a wealth management in banking language, where we said that, okay, what's the prices, how the prices are moving up. You should not sell everything at one go. So if you have put, say, 2 tons or 1 ton, let's keep something, sell something kind of thing. So that's the portfolio management thing. The third thing the farmers say is that it's too much of a risk. So there's a risk management in terms of farmers, that how do you trade on this platform? So it's the daily pricing. There's a call center, the other platform where we educate them. So there's a behavioral change, making farmer from just producer to a market participant, or you can say a trader. So that's where our tagline says, Mera Anaj, Meri Punji, and also that empowering participation, that is Sasakt or Sammilit Kisan, that is what we say. So this is what we are trying to do. The traction has been pretty good till now. This is how our warehouses look. Same as the standard of any warehousing company. And we are further improving it. And we are saying that this is bank. So this is a new concept in that sense. Though the operation looks very similar to warehousing. So traction has been very good till now. And this tagline, Aapka Anaj, Aapki Punji, we have changed it to Mera Anaj, Meri Punji now. So Bhandaran loan in Bikwali. So that is storage, loan, and selling support. So this is what we do right now. Traction has been good. We have been adding 40-50 warehouses every month. So we have moved out of Bihar now. So we are in Karnataka and Maharashtra as we speak today. We'll be getting into other states. And we hope that in 2 or 3 years' time, we'll be reaching to maybe 2.5 million farmers, and we'll be managing an asset of 8 to 10,000 crores of grain for the farmer. And imagine if they get 20-30% extra benefit, farmers. So on 8,000 crore grains, so 1,600. So 2,000 crores worth of extra benefits or impact getting to the farmers. If that happens, that will be the time we say that, okay, we have created a business where the last person has the maximum benefit, and of course every stakeholder with Argos also benefits. So this is what we do. So I think I have spoken enough. So let's hear from all of you if it interests you, if it makes any sense or not. So you, I welcome participation from your side. Does it make sense? Hello.
Yes sir.
Okay. So this is what I wanted to say. There's a long presentation, but I just wanted to tell that this is why we do and how we do. So if you look at the vision and mission, there's a lot of, we say that we want to increase farmers' income by 50%. That's something which from our side we do. And then storage related problems are there. The credit related problem. The sales related problems. So this. I have tried talking to you. So, and the market size is huge. You know how much we produce, and so these are the market opportunities where we are trying to reach to the closest to the farm. So that's the way I would like to put it.
So can I ask one question?
Sure.
So where did you get this idea? I mean, what was the origin of this idea that you came with?
Okay, so I joined it late, right? So it was started by the co-founders called Kishore Jha and Praveen Kumar. So this, I just saw their photograph. So these are the two gentlemen who started it, Kishore Jha and Praveen. So Kishore is basically a banker. So he's worked in bank, and Praveen is a HR professional. They were both in, they're both from Bihar, and they both worked in Bangalore. So serendipity, they came together. And because they both come from farming families in that sense. So they were, every time they would see that, okay, there's a lot of problems selling this grain and there's a lot of losses. So from there, they got this idea, but it started from a place called Pusa. And there's a place in Samastipur district, Pusa, there's an agriculture university where I also study. So in Pusa, they started this business, like what you hear from most of the businesses started from garage or something. It started under a tree, kadam tree. So they had taken a small place there. So they had a tree, they had a small thatched roof house, one laptop and a lot of energy. So that's where it started.
Wow, so that was really great to hear. Really inspirational for freshers like us who are intending to bring some changes in the society in the future.
Sure.
So can we take up some more questions?
Yeah.
So would you want to proceed with the presentation? We'll take it towards the end.
I think this is pretty much the presentation. Other things are just English, right? So I'll say this is the crux of it. So what it was trying to tell, because the management student, so like look at the core of the problem. The core of the problem is that there is a long value chain, and this value chain or supply chain, whichever way you want to describe it. So I describe it as value chain. So not just for the farming, for any commodity or any producer, say this, the chain is very long. And when you have long chain and there's a lot of joints in that chain, so it changes, the material changes hand multiple times, right? So every joint bleeds, right? So all the companies, what we are trying to do and trying to plug in those leaks. And those leaks, it's everyone says that, okay, we lose 30% to 50% fruits and vegetable in post-harvest handling, and there's a lot of food loss. And we know those problems, right? But how do we think in a newer way to plug those gaps? So what we are doing is that we know that, okay, there's a farmer who is producing, there's a market who is buying and using it, and there's five people in between. Okay, can we connect it directly? And everyone, this is everyone's discussion that, okay, we should do it. But when you look at the infrastructural part, how do you do it? When you look at technology part, how do you do it? When you look at the behavioral and psychological part of participate. So unless we look at it's in holistically, we will not be able to do everything ourselves. So we need partners, we need support. But one or two core things where we see that, okay, this is where I can do it. So we are saying that this value chain will be plugging, say 10% or 15% or 20% of the losses. There's still 70, 80% losses or 90% losses. Somebody else also need to come in. These are large problems. So my advice is that when you're looking at not any business or any job or anything, look at it holistically and say that which place we can do it. And believe me, there's always a way to do it.
Absolutely right. So where there is a will, there is a way. And we have a wonderful business model here.
That's, so we are growing fast. Yeah.
One of the questions which has been posted is, Argos on ground operations are backed by a comprehensive tech platform, right, which assists the end-to-end process and operations, starting from farmer onboarding to final sale. So what do you do about the digital literacy of the farmer and the internet connectivity in remote areas? Are they a barrier to your business model?
So I'll say both say yes and no. Okay. Yes, because we have this technical glitches. Like even in I'm sitting in Patna, and there has been glitches in my presentation as well. Okay. But these are not deal breakers. What happens is that, one, you say that there's a mobile app. So most of the business is done by mobile app. And there are many people who don't have smartphones. How do they do it? Right. So then we do a little bit of workaround. So there's a village champion, there's a SMS, there's a phone call. So there's some medium involved somebody can do on behalf of that person. So that's one thing. Second is this barrier is vanishing so fast. We work in one of the most economically poorer area of India, in some of the deepest villages in India. There also we find that there's at least one smartphone in a home. That farmer may not be carrying it, but someone in the family, son, daughter, is there. So there is a teacher available inside the family, right? And as we say, the collaboration, so it's not always competition. So WhatsApp, Facebook, YouTube, you will not believe that the YouTube following or the Facebook following or some of the influencers, you say, some of the folk singers are into 3 million, 4 million kind of thing. So these people are consuming a lot of digital content, not by ours. So it's developing so fast, and there is a teacher inside a family, everyone. We do feel it the problem, but the problem is vanishing maybe at a rate of 50-60% every year. So maybe 2 years, 3 years. Then initially we had a little bit of problem, not just on the digital literacy, but maybe banking literacy. When we say that, okay, we'll deposit money into your bank account. Okay. And then that was a bigger problem. So you will send an OTP, then there's a lot of apprehensions still there, but thanks to the demonetization kind of thing, everyone moved to there. So there's some opportunity comes which makes quantum jump. So we do find a problem. The internet connectivity, mobile internet, our apps are all suitable for mobile grade, 2G grade speed that can work. So it's not very heavy. So these are the things you need to do so that it doesn't take time to load. We are also collaborating with things like broadband connectivity in all panchayats. So we are working with multiple agencies, government agencies also, to ensure that in area where we work has higher connectivity and all this. So there's a lot of work going on, but I'll say it's not stopping us to do business.
Right, sir. So one of the things you mentioned was that this food grain which is stored, you also help the farmers to sell this food grain. So, sir, who are the customers of this food grain that you have in your banks? And do these prospective buyers, they have to become members of your app?
Yes. So they have to log in into our app. That's one. So right now it's kind of free. So what happens is that we have more than 300 buyers right now. So these are bigger companies who, like poultry companies, maida companies. We work in three major commodity as we speak today: paddy, wheat, and maize. So there's a poultry, there's flour mills, there's rice mills. So these are people who buy. So our endeavor is that we should have purchases directly from this millers, the end user, end processor. Okay, but there are people who are bigger traders also. They are also on our platform. So they need to log in into our platform. So what they do is, so everyone who is onboarded, given a login credential, and they have the visibility where at which place what grains we have, what quantity and what quality, and so they can put in offers. So like I am a buyer, say I'm ITC, I want 100 tons of wheat from say Muzaffarpur. I'll say I want to buy from Muzaffarpur at 1900 rupees, right? So you will put in 1900 rupees, 100 tons I want to. So this buyer is mapped to some of, like Muzaffarpur I said, so all the warehouses, all the farmers who are connected to that warehouses will get that offer on their mobile app. Okay, this ITC, so they will not know which buyer all the time, right? They know there's a buy offer at X price. So there's a little bit of, you can say margin, where we say supply chain margin. So they will say, they will get that visibility that, okay, this is the price which is there in the market today. So there can be multiple prices. So ITC wants at 1900 rupees, NABC company wants at 1800 rupees, somebody wants at 1950 rupees. So whichever, of course, the highest farmers will choose, so they can choose and execute. So it's basically we are not trader. We are not selling on behalf of farmer, right? It's farmer who has to sell. So buyer has to put their offer, farmer has to accept it. And similarly, farmer also can keep it giving the offer that I have 2 tons of grain, I want to sell it at X price, right? So this aggregation happens on this technology platform. And both sides, so it's like matchmaking, who wants to buy from where. So that is how it happens. So we are not a trader. It's not that we buy from farmer and then sell it to someone. Okay. So it's we are a platform, and we provide the safety and security of the grain in a way that is tradable. We provide that infrastructure and fungibility where the buyers can get the lot size and the quality, and farmers are able to sell it in one bag.
So generally, farmers have trust in the local mandis owned by the government. So right. On that front, do you sometimes experience a challenge as to how to convince the farmer to come and deposit grain in your grain banks rather than the government mandi?
So two things. We started working in Bihar where there is no grain mandi. So APMC has been abolished here, but government does purchase, and we do find sometimes issue. But the government purchase here in Bihar is very small. But wherever it is, so there are two kind of purchases in mandi. One is the government buys, and second is the government provides the mandi, somebody, the private parties buys, right? So what we are telling, ma'am, is farmers not to sell immediately. Like mandi, they go to sell immediately, right? And the model, what we are saying is telling them not to sell immediately. So there's no competition in that sense. The competition is then to build the mentality that do they want to sell it immediately, or do they want to store it and sell it when the market is right? So there's a resistance or problem shifting to this mindset that, okay, I need to sell it immediately, right? So there's a competition psychologically there. Otherwise, the business is completely different. We are not telling them to sell it immediately. We are telling them, why do you want to sell it immediately? Everyone knows that the prices are lowest at the time of harvest, right? And they want to sell it because, one, they want money, so there's a loan available. They don't have storage, so there's a storage available. But still, there are trust. Who is Argos? What will happen if you don't honor commitment? We don't know you. So all these things are there, like any other business. So we create warehouses, we brand it. Our village champions are local, but it still takes some time to create that trust within the community. But there's no competition for mandi because we are not buying. We are not telling people to sell it immediately.
So what about the quality of grains? Because you are, allowing small farmers to come and deposit, maybe as small an amount as 1 sack. So yeah. Aggregation from small farmers and, so how do you sort of take care of the quality issue there? Can you have uniform quality of the grain?
So I think that is, you have pointed the most, I think most important question we also dealing. It's, when you involve material, when you take it, so there's a proper quality check and we accept only say A grade quality at this point in time, right? The farmers also understand there's a moisture, there's a broken, there's a damaged discolor, there's a foreign material. So there's a let down, right? And we involved only one grade of material, right? We don't find much problem there. The problem is that when the incoming quality is not good, right? So we reject it, right? So when we reject it, the farmer goes back to the same unorganized market, and then he has a problem. He says that, okay, good quality we have given to Argos, bad quality is coming to somebody else, and then all the problem starts. But wherever we are for 3-4 years, and then farmers understand that, okay, good quality has better returns. Okay, so we have this program in terms of how to manage the quality after harvest and also pre-harvest, but still it's not sufficient. So it for inwarding we don't have a problem because there's a protocol set in, but we are working on this, that can we have two different qualities stored, because everything is not A grade all the time, right? So we are working on that, how do we do it. Fortunately in maize, wheat and paddy, you have very set pattern or set system of segregation, but we are working on that. We are also working on how do we increase the A grade quantum in the total produce, but that is it still remains that we'll not be able to take 100% of farmers produce. The quality, it doesn't match warehousing requirement, and it's not with just with us. So any grain which is produced for to be warehouseable, because it has to be kept for 8-9 months, right? It has to have certain quality. Whatever is not meeting has to be sold immediately. So there's a local market for that. We are also working on that. How do we work on this immediate sale? How do we facilitate that, right? So we are working on that, but this is a large problem that all grains are not uniform. What we can store is one quality which can be traded. There's a lot of grain which is outside that quality, and that requires some solution. So we are working on that, and we are also conscious that all the problems will not be able to solve all the problems. There's place for other people also, but we are working on multiple things, and maybe that's an area of new innovation. How do we do drying at smaller warehouses when there is no electricity? Can we have smaller machines to dry it up? One of the major problem in quality is moisture, right? Can we segregate it? Can we create sieves, etc. at smaller warehouses? And can we create hubs for that? Can we collaborate with some entrepreneur who can do and give it to us? So we are working on that aspect. So there's a lot to be done. We have done only a small portion of it. So I'm giving a lot of business ideas. If so, anyone wants to do it, welcome.
Sir, I just want, I would like to request you to kindly stop your sharing, please.
Yeah, let me.
Yeah, thank you, sir. Thank you.
So, a lot of ideas. I think a lot of thought-provoking things you have shared. So people would have already started thinking what they can work. One last question, sir, and a quick one. What do you see the repercussions of the farmer's bill in your line of work?
Okay, so I'm not the best person to answer this. But frankly, I see whatever I understand of farmers and farmer bill and other things. So in Bihar, because there's no APMC, so there's hardly any change, right? But wherever there has been farm bill, in my view, I don't find even a single clause which should concern anyone, right? The only thing is where, because this is a gray area, which is MSP, right? So So when you look at minimum support price, has never been a law. It is an administrative order, right? And so all the apprehension that once it is not mandatory to come to the mandi, okay, government will take away this MSP. Okay, that's if you look at that apprehension kind of thing, because there is no answer of yes and no. What we can see in last 2 years is that it's not going down, and it's very difficult to take out because it's politically very sensitive. But somehow, if you look at the bill, we have correlated this MSP to the farm bill. These two very different things, but this got correlated. But the apprehension, I will say, it's you can't say yes or no on both sides, because maybe this is not politically correct to say, but I'll say that MSP is not maintainable, right? If you look at the commodity market in India, and if you look at the farmers' income, yes, they need that income 2 times, 1.5 times kind of thing, we'll say it. But when you look at commodity market internationally, we are way too high priced, right? So all the one side you give this MSP, another side you do this increase the duty and other things so that import doesn't come in all. Okay? So this is like a vicious cycle, and it's a kind of trap. We have been trapped into that. So MSP will keep there, because no government can antagonize farmer in that sense. But we'll have to think of a better thing for MSP. Okay. So if we leave that, then there should not be any problem, because if you look at many states like Bihar, Kerala, other, we don't have mandi system, still it's working. But there are counter argument that Bihar prices are lowest, so that's another thing. But fruits and vegetables, we don't have that. There are many other commodity where private mandis are allowed. So like the earlier company I worked, Basmati Rice company. So there are many private mandis there. So these are all working fine, right? And mandi, wherever it is, it's very difficult to abolish, because nobody else can create that platform. So if not to complicate thing, I'll say that as such, if we look at the farm bills, I think it's a welcome thing. It's a very forward looking thing. But when you look at MSP, yes, this is a gray area, and that need to be addressed, that how long it will be there, will it be there, can it be law or administrative order, so that for the government to think. But in my view, it's very difficult to make it law, because suppose, I'll just give you a perspective. So like paddy price today is, MSP is I think 1960 or something has gone in, right? If you look at paddy traded prices today, outside MSP, it will be on an average around 1500 rupees, 1300 to 1600 rupees, depending on different locations, right? And if government has to buy everything in 1960, the minimum price you will pay for rice will increase by 30-40%, right? So you subsidize at one end, what do you do with the consumers? So out of 200 million tons of rice and wheat, what we produce, we purchase how much? 50, 60, 70 million tons. So 60% of it is still outside MSP. So if you make it law, all will come under 100%. And anyone buying less than MSP goes to jail, right? So this is a very tricky question. I'm not the best person to it. But on terms of farm law, I think Bihar, we have, because it was not there, so we don't see repercussions. Anywhere else also, we don't see a lot of negative impact. But we'll have to wait for it to settle down. We don't know how, which way. Oot kis karvat baithega, abhi pata nahi.
Sure, sir. Let's hope for the best. And thank you so very much, sir, for answering all those questions so very patiently. And I think this session was a big eye-opener for a lot of us who were really not acquainted, you know, that we can have these kind of business models. And this is what can be done in the agri space also. So thanks a ton, sir. I'll hand it back to the compares now.
Thank you. My pleasure.
Thank you, ma'am. May I now request Student Manager Parv Agarwal to deliver the vote of thanks.
It is my immense pleasure to propose the vote of thanks for this event to dignitaries present here. I, Parv Agarwal, on behalf of Balaji Institute of Modern Management, Sri Balaji Institute family, extend our deep gratitude to our honorable guest speaker, Mr. Ashutosh Kumar Sinha, who has taken out his valuable time from his busy schedule and honored us with the presence to interact with all of us today. Some of the key learnings from the sessions are science and technology, coupled with improved human capital, have been powerful drivers of positive change in the performance and evaluation of smaller holder system. And nothing is more expensive than a missing opportunity. We will inculcate these lessons in our life for a better future ahead. Sir, we thank you for being with us, and it has been a privilege listening to you. We have gained a lot from you, and we will look forward to many more interactions with you, off as well as on the campus. Thank you.
Thanks. It's my pleasure, and all the best for your future endeavors. Thank you.
Ashutosh sir, we request you to stay back for a minute, sir.
Sure.
Thank you, Parv. I now request Professor Ramesh Jadhav, Department of Business Analytics and IT, to present a token of gratitude to our guest, Ashutosh Sinha, sir.
Ashutosh sir, thank you so much. First of all, I must tell you, you are very good at technology. Reason being, you faced a problem. Then I asked, should I help you? But then you got out of the meeting, you resolved the problem. Thank you so much for that, sir. Sir, on behalf of directors, faculty members, student managers, and staff of Sri Balaji University, Pune, I would like to thank you for such an enriching session. It was a great learning experience for all of us to know about digitizing grains produced by farmers. And in fact, it was great to know the concept of grain bank. On behalf of Balaji Institute of Modern Management, BIMM family, we would like to present you this book titled Brand Activism by Christian Sarkar and Philip Portla. Same book will be couriered to you. It will reach to you within another 3-4 days time, sir. Thank you once again for sharing your knowledge and wisdom with regard to this grain bank, and what you're doing is a really great thing. Over to computers. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. With this, we come to the end of Marketing Symposium 2021, organized by Balaji Institute of Modern Management, BIMM, Pune. We are thankful to all the corporate stalwarts who spoke to us today for sparing their valuable time to contribute towards the learnings of the future student managers of Balaji Institute of Modern Management, BIMM, in particular, and Sri Balaji University, Pune, at large. We also sincerely thank all the parents and family members of all student managers for constantly supporting us and encouraging us in such endeavors. Good wishes to all the student managers, parents, and family members for the ongoing Navratri festival and Dashera. Thank you and good evening, everybody. Take very good care of yourself. Stay safe and cheerful.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. It was wonderful. Thank you, sir.